All right, folks, we're here for Pests and Pathogens of Honeybees today. This is a pretty long lecture. It covers a lot of material, and it's formatted a little differently than I normally do my lectures. As I'm sure many of you have noticed, I like to use a lot of pictures in most of our lectures. I don't like to use a lot of text. But this is a very detailed lecture. There's a lot of information embedded in this. And so you'll notice on the slides, there is quite a lot of text. And the reason that I do that is you should be utilizing these lectures for review purposes later on. After you've gone through the class, you want a refresher over the winter or something like that. So there is a lot of information in here. It's a very dense lecture. And so take your time going through this. I hope you enjoy it, but we're going to cover a lot of material that really is very pertinent to your success as a beekeeper. One of the things I tell folks that are just getting into beekeeping is generally, you're not going to fully understand all the pests and pathogens and how to actually diagnose for them when you're doing hive inspections. But one thing I want to just embed into your mind right now is it is critical for you as a beekeeper to understand what doesn't look right. And so we're going to cover a lot of symptoms today that just don't look right in a healthy beehive. And for those of you that have been watching the lectures, that have been coming to the on-ground sessions, you know what a healthy beehive looks like, what a good brood pattern looks like, what healthy brood looks like. And what we're going to talk about is the symptoms that are not right today. And so whether you understand what exactly the pathogen or the pest is that you're dealing with, you should be able to basically look at a hive and understand that it just doesn't look right. And that's at that point is where you take photos of what's going on, you reference your research materials, you come back to this lecture, you give your local entomologist a call like myself and discuss the problem with them in detail. But it is important that you understand what doesn't look right. And that is just a basic thing you need to take with you as you are looking through your hives and as you are really kind of going for a basic hive inspection. So we'll start with this. Well, beekeeping then. So back in the early days of American beekeeping, really kind of the mid to late 1800s, moving into the 1900s, beekeeping was a pretty easy deal. Most of the time you put your hives out in the season and you come back at the end of the season and you harvest honey and the bees are just there. They proliferate year after year. You don't see a lot of overwintering loss. It was the golden age of beekeeping. We are far from that now. We are in a situation now where beekeeping really has become not so much managing the honeybee, but rather managing for pests and pathogens. And so the beekeeper and what we have to know as our personal knowledge is very different from what it used to be. So it really is imperative that you are on your game when it comes to understanding what looks right and what doesn't look right in a hive, and really honing your skills to understand even more completely the pests and pathogens that are affecting your bees. So some of the things that you need to know when you're trying to manage and monitor for major pests and pathogens. Well, the things that you're going to be doing as part of your regular beekeeping activities are hive inspections. And we've talked about this a lot. It is crucial that you inspect your hives every 3 to 4 weeks. The reason we use that 3 to 4 week turnaround is because the honeybee life cycle of a worker is 21 days. And so you're able to see what's going on after each complete brood hatch out. So hive inspections are important. Every single one of you should be doing regular hive inspections as part of your regular maintenance on your beehive. You're gonna need to really hone your visual identification skills. There's not a ton of pests that affect honeybees. We're really talking about a handful of organisms. And so being able to visually ID them is something you need to be practicing. You need to be looking at pictures. You need to be looking in your hives. And when you see things, you need to either take a photo, collect them, something. But you need to confirm what those individuals are. So honing your identification skills is going to be a really important part of being able to manage your pests and pathogens. You've also got to be able to understand symptoms. Now, I said at the beginning of the lecture, you don't have to understand all of this if you're just getting started, but you need to understand what looks right and what doesn't. A nice solid brood pattern is a healthy brood pattern. When you start seeing spotty patterns with sunken caps, chewed away larvae, all of this kind of stuff, those are symptoms that tell you something is wrong. In addition, you need to understand, is what I'm looking at serious enough to have to take action? You know, we don't just take action because we see one pest. We take action when the pest pressure has reached a level that we consider harmful to our bees. In the entomology realm, we call that an economic threshold. It's the threshold at which your pests reach a high enough level to where it starts costing you money. That is when you have to take action. You don't want to hit that economic threshold. You got to actually take action a little bit before that. We call that an action threshold. So kind of, you got to be able to monitor things. And when you hit those thresholds, being an action threshold, you need to be able to take action. You need to understand that, is this serious enough to actually take action? Or is it just something that's at a low level at this point and I don't need to take action? You also need to understand your treatment options. And this is particularly important for some of our more serious pests like varroa mites. There are lots of treatment options out there, and we're going to talk about most of them. But I will warn you, not all treatment options are effective. There are many treatment options that actually have that actually mites have developed resistance to and actually don't do a very good job of controlling mites. You would not want to use those treatments because essentially what that is selective pressure. You kill some of the mites, but the mites that you leave are totally resistant to the pesticide that you're using, the miticide that you're using. In those situations, what you'll actually get into is you'll actually start essentially creating an environment where you're breeding for mites that are resistant to your controls. And so we'll talk about treatment options and the importance of using not only appropriate treatment options, but also rotating treatment options so that you're not always using the same thing to kill mites. All right, so as part of your hive inspections, you're gonna do monthly inspections, like we talked about, every 3 to 4 weeks. And it's really critical as part of your integrated pest management program to keep inspection notes. This is paramount as far as importance, because what's gonna happen is that you're gonna go and inspect these hives, and 3 weeks later, you're gonna inspect them again. And if something was going on at that first inspection, I guarantee you, you're not gonna remember it in 3 weeks. If you started seeing signs of maybe parasitic mite syndrome, or maybe something like European foul brood, that needs to be in your notes. If you're seeing things like mite infestation getting higher because you're doing regular sugar roll tests or alcohol washes, those need to be in your notes. And those are going to inform your decisions later on when you're actually seeing things that are getting to a level at which you need to do something. You're also going to inspect your brood during your monthly inspections. You're going to look for pattern, that solid brood pattern. Queens are excellent at what they do, and they don't miss any of those cells. So if you're seeing very spotty brood patterns, that's an indication that something's wrong. You're also going to look for eggs and larvae. You're going to look for not only the presence of eggs to ensure that you have a queen right colony, but you're also going to look for larvae that looks healthy. Larvae should always be a bright white color. If it is off color, that is a symptom that something is wrong. You're also going to want to look for a queen being present. That is just part of your regular inspection, that you have a queen present. Now, again, you can determine that if you have eggs, or you can determine that by looking and actually seeing a queen. You're also going to look at how well the colony is drawing wax. Some colonies, you know, may not be drawing wax because something's going on as far as health concerns. You're also going to look at food in the colony, the presence of honey and pollen, making sure that it's in adequate amounts. Hives that are starving oftentimes will be subject to all sorts of problems. Bacterial problems like European foul brood is a key one that tends to show up early in the season when we have stressed out bees, where there's not enough forage around. We tend to see things like shortages of honey and pollen in those situations, and that will cause stress-related or more susceptibility to bacterial infection because of stress. We're also going to look at colony size and vigor when we're doing our inspections, and that's, we've talked about this, about counting the frames. So you look down in the colony, you look at frames, both front and back, and you count the number of frames that have bees on the front and back of them, covered on the front and back of them. This is a rough estimate that gives you an idea of how many bees you have in your colony. Now, for example, the reason this is important, because if you go out one day, 1 month, and you see that you've got 20 frames of bees, and you come back 3 weeks later and see that you have 10 frames of bees in the same exact colony, that's an indication that something's going on. Maybe you had a swarm, but maybe you're experiencing some sort of disease presence that's causing colony decline. So all of these parameters that you take into consideration when you're collecting data as part of your regular inspection, they can inform your decisions very, very well when it comes to actually dealing with pests and pathogens. All right, so I'm going to show you a couple management philosophies that we see typically in the beekeeping industry. And there's three scenarios here that I put together. So it really, the question is, do we treat or not treat? And there's a lot of folks that have a lot of opinions about this. And I'm going to give you mine. But the important thing to keep in mind is that in each one of these scenarios, there are consequences and well, there's pluses and minuses to our action or inaction. All right, so the first scenario, let's say this is beekeeper one. This beekeeper takes the approach that if you find a problem, you treat it with the maximum amount of chemicals. So in this scenario, we're talking about individuals that are not really monitoring very closely. They may monitor on a few hives in a yard, but they're primarily monitoring for presence. And this happens a lot with some commercial beekeepers. And the reason is because they have way too much invested to have something go wrong. I mean, you have apiaries that are 100 plus colonies. If something gets going in an apiary like that, it can run like wildfire. And so a lot of times, these particular beekeepers will just use the maximum treatment for whatever the problem might be. Say it's varroa mites. You know, they find a few varroa mites in a few hives, and they're just gonna, you know, they're gonna use the maximum amount of treatment through the entire apiary. And maybe they weren't at the treatment threshold that we recommend, but they found the pest, and they're gonna treat with maximum pressure. Now, this can work in some situations, but what this does is by treating with the maximum amount of chemicals all the time, you're essentially creating a situation in which you can create pest resistance to that chemical. If every time you treat for something, say for example for mites, you are putting selective pressure on that mite. And although a lot of the products that we use, well, I won't say a lot of them, but some of them have not shown resistance developing over time, many of them do. And so in this situation, by using the maximum amount of chemicals, even when there may not be a problem that is really causing issues, that can cause resistance because of that selective pressure. So you kill all of the mites that are susceptible to the pesticide or the miticide, but you don't kill the ones that are resistant. And those are the ones that continue breeding after your treatment. In addition, this can also create a situation where you get weak genetics. So a lot of the genetics that we have been breeding for decades are focused on varroa mite sensitivity. So the bee actually being able to perceive that varroa mite is in the hive, they will actually attack the hive or attack the mite and then remove it. So if we're treating all the time with the maximum amount of chemicals, oftentimes those nuanced genetic differences will not really show up, and we'll end up over time developing a weak genetic line that really has no ability to deal with varroa on its own. All right, management philosophy two, monitor hives and only treat when absolutely necessary. Now, this is the strategy that we use at Heroes of Hives, at MSU. Most good, successful beekeepers that I know, this is the strategy that they use. We monitor, just like we do our sugar roll tests, every single month, and we only treat when we reach the threshold of treatment, which in varroa mites, we use basically a 3% infectivity threshold, and we'll talk about that a little later on. But essentially, when you hit that threshold, you know that you have mite pressure that is getting really high, and if you don't do something, you're gonna hit that economic loss threshold that we talked about earlier. You don't wanna hit economic loss. You wanna prevent economic loss at every turn. And the way that we do that is by developing these action thresholds, and that's the 3% infectivity level. So you might lose some bees in this process because obviously we're never at a point where there are no pests. We just keep pests underneath underneath the thresholds that we've set. So what this does is basically this is what we call an integrated pest management approach where we monitor and we treat only when necessary. And what this does is it minimizes the development of resistance in the bees, because you're only treating when they are actually at thresholds that are high enough to really cause issues. And it minimizes the pest and disease prevalence. So when it comes to being a successful beekeeper, this is really the strategies, particularly for small scale beekeepers, that you want to use. You only want to treat when absolutely necessary. And we determine that based off of monitoring. Now, number three, our beekeeper here is, well, we just don't treat. And we most of these beekeepers who don't treat, most often they're called natural beekeepers. They call themselves natural beekeepers. Most of these individuals don't even monitor for pests. I have had many situations, I mean, hundreds of situations over the last decade of beekeeping, where I've interacted with natural beekeepers. And most of them have very little hands-on experience with their bees. They take the notion that the bees will essentially evolve the defenses to deal with all of these issues. In my opinion, this is not an acceptable approach. This is like just leaving bees to do what they're going to do. And, you know, 99.9% of the time, these are the same beekeepers that call themselves beekeepers, but lose 100% of their hives every year, or you know, some really crazy amount of bees that they lose every year. That is not an acceptable approach to beekeeping. We are not in the business of killing bees. We're in the business of keeping bees alive. And by not doing anything, just letting, you know, Mother Nature take its course, that is an absolutely not acceptable approach for a beekeeper. And any of you taking this class, I hope I instill in you, every single one of you, how important it is to monitor for problems. Individuals that are not monitoring for problems, that are not treating for issues, these are the individuals that are really causing problems for a lot of us. The thing about this whole idea of natural beekeeping and bees being able to sort things out by themselves, yes, bees evolve over time, but evolution takes a very long time to take place. And you're dealing with a situation in which European honeybees are not co-evolved with varroa mite. They've only been together for a very short period of time over the span of evolution. And so because they've only had a very brief relationship, really in the modern era only, that you're not gonna see evolution taking its course that quickly. We as scientists have been working on breeding efforts, concerted scientific breeding efforts to deal with varroa mite since the mid-90s. And we still are having trouble getting those genes to fix in those genetic lines so that we actually have genetic lines that are truly resistant to varroa mite. Evolution is a very slow process. You are not going to see any sort of evolved resistance to varroa mite in your short period of keeping bees. It's not going to happen. And so the idea that it is going to happen is a complete fallacy. That is not an adequate approach to keeping bees. These individuals tend to have high losses, high disease presence, and really high pest pressure, and they become reservoirs for pests and pathogens. So you may keep your bees just fine. You may monitor, you may treat, you may have very clean bees, but your buddy 2 miles down the street who's a natural beekeeper who doesn't do anything, I guarantee you, over time, those bees are going to abscond, those bees are going to interact with your hives, those bees are going to become susceptible to robbing, and what's going to happen is your bees are going to interact with them, and you're going to take on their problem. It is very important that if you know somebody who is not doing anything with their hives, that number one, you educate them, because that's the right thing to do. But number two, if it is affecting your colonies, you need to either one, move your apiary or do something about this, because these individuals really are causing problems for most of us. Most of us are good at what we do when it comes to monitoring and treating. It only takes one individual in a community that is doing nothing to really create an issue for everybody else. So this is, and really this is one of the main reasons that varroa mites are at epidemic levels in the US right now. 100% of colonies in the US have varroa mites, 100%. You have to monitor and manage them in order to ensure your colonies survive. If you do nothing, your colonies will have varroa mite proliferate, and that proliferation will then spread to colonies all around you. All right, so now we're going to jump into the meat of this lecture. And like I said, this is a pretty lengthy lecture. So we're going to start with the pests of honeybees. All right, so we have varroa mites, tracheal mites, wax moths, small hive beetles, and then we'll talk about some vertebrate pests as well. Now, these are the main players that I'm going to be talking about today. There's some things that I'm not going to be touching on, but these are the main things that you're going to be dealing with as a beekeeper. All right, so the number one problem for beekeepers is varroa mites, varroa destructor. It is a global parasite. It is, like I said, 100% of colonies in the United States are affected by them. And the way the varroa mite works is that it feeds on the fat bodies of honeybees. The fat bodies are essentially what's akin to our liver. It's the organ inside of honeybees that detoxifies environmental contaminants. It is also the organ that is responsible for developing large fat stores for our winter bees. Winter bees need large amounts of fat deposits in their body in order to survive that long winter. So our regular bees during the summer, our summer bees, live 45 to 60 days. In northern climates, your winter bees will live somewhere between 4 and 6 months. That's a very different lifespan and requires a very different biology in order to make that happen. One of the main reasons let me back up. When you have varroa mite infestation, high infestation in the fall, typically you will see your colonies die before the new year. And the reason that happens is because the fat body is so damaged that the winter bees cannot put on those fat stores. And so essentially they just can't survive a long period of time. That's why you see dead outs early in the season, typically with high mite load. And that's something to just keep in mind. So it is really critical to keep mites under control, because if those fat bodies are affected on a large number of bees, you're compromising the entire health of your colony as far as the ability to overwinter. The host of varroa mite, originally the host was Apis serrana, the Asian honeybee. That is where varroa mite originally came from. At some point in time, we started moving European honeybee colonies into Southeast Asia, where Apis serrana, its native range is. And what we saw is that the varroa mite in Apis serrana is very well controlled. The Asian honeybee has the ability to detect the smells, the very nuanced differences in smell between bees and the varroa mite. And we'll talk about why that's a problem, why that's so difficult for European honeybees in just a moment. But they can detect and remove, they basically can detect, they will attack, and they will remove varroa mites in their colonies actively. That's Apis serrana. And so we typically don't see really problems with varroa mite in Apis serrana because they're co-evolved. And with evolution, basically within the natural world, evolution's like an arms race. Essentially, the pest will evolve some sort of change over a long period of time that gives it a leg up on its host. And then the host, over a long period of time, will evolve some sort of defense to take care of the pest. Because these two organisms are co-evolved, they've essentially been doing this arms race for thousands of years. And so there have been some changes that have happened that allow each one of them to survive. And so it kind of creates this balance. Typically with Apis serrana, we don't see very high mite loads. But the reason is because the mites that are coming in the bees are able to detect them, attack them, and remove them. The varroa mite has a 10-day life cycle, which essentially starts with a phoretic mite, a mite that hitches a ride on a honeybee. That honeybee then comes into the colony, that mite jumps off, then searches out unsealed brood. It will then find unsealed brood, it will pop into that brood cell, and then essentially what we see once the varroa mite is in the brood is it tucks itself under the larvae and hides. And once that cell is capped, we then see the female mite that goes in. She will then lay a series of eggs of other females and then one male. So generally you see 2 to 3 females that will be laid and one male that will be laid. So for every one mite that goes in, you tend to have 2 to 3, sometimes more, gravid females, meaning mated females. They mate with their brother in the cell. But those mated females then come out when the new bee hatches. And so essentially what happens is you have this exponential growth. As one mite goes in, three to five come out that are ready to do the same thing. And that's why varroa mite gets to be such a problem so fast. The 3% infectivity level is really critical, because if you wait any longer than that, it's an exponential growth rate. And really, you'll go from, you know, 3 mites per 300 bees to, you know, 20 or 30 or 40 mites per 300 bees, maybe in just a few weeks. It can happen that fast. So you really have to be on your game when it comes to monitoring and treating for varroa mite. It was introduced in the U.S. in the mid-80s. It's about the size of a pinhead, so this is visible with the naked eye. However, one of the big things that I hear from people who never treat for varroa mite is, I've never seen it in my colony. You will never see it in your colony unless it is at epidemic proportions. Generally, the mites, because they're feeding on the fat body, which is located on the underside of the abdomen, they hide underneath the segments of the abdomen so that they can feed, they can get between those segments that overlap on the abdomen. In between those segments, you can access kind of soft tissue. So, you know, you can't chew through those sclerotized, those hardened segments, but the mites get underneath those segments. And that's why you don't see them, because they're generally always under the segments. If you see them walking around, you've got some serious mite load happening. So just keep that in mind, that it is visible with the naked eye, but typically you're not going to see it in the colony. You're only going to see it when you're doing your monitoring. They tend to be an orange to brown color, and they're kind of oval in shape, but very visible with the naked eye. All right, so the big thing with varroa mite, it vectors over 20 viruses that impact bee development. And a couple of these, K-wing virus, which is what you see on this bottom right picture here. K-wing virus is basically, there is a, so if you remember from your biology lecture, there is a row of hooks on the forewing that connect with the hind wing that allow the wings to basically clamp together so that you can increase surface area when you're flapping your wings to develop lift. K-wing virus affects that humili, that's the hooks that basically hook on. By affecting those hooks, it means that the two wings cannot connect. So this bee right here, this drone right here, is gonna have a very difficult time ever getting off the ground, because he cannot connect those two the hind wing and the forewing together to produce enough lift. So that's K-wing virus. Deformed wing virus is what you see here on the bottom left. Essentially, deformed wing virus affects the development of wings during the pupal stage. And the wings that you see here, they look like they've been burnt by a matchstick. Those wings will never develop. That bee will never fly. And deformed wing virus is one of the major viruses that affect honeybees through varroa mites. And it affects honeybees, you know, in a very critical way. A hive full of deformed wing virus affected bees is a colony that cannot fly, essentially. And we all know how important that is to just basic living of honeybees. Bee paralysis. There's all sorts of bee paralysis viruses that affect honeybees. And typically the symptom that you see is this top picture. You see that most, you know, our bees, you know, generally they're very furry. And we've talked about the fact that they lose their hair over time. This area right here of the thorax will tend to get a little bald over time. But bees are furry overall. When you see these glossy bees with no hair, that is an indication of paralysis. This is not a healthy bee. That particular bee will probably have all sorts of other symptoms that go along with that basically that greasy color that we see, you know, that hairless color. Oftentimes you will see them shaking, and that is an indication of paralysis. So these bees are not healthy either. And these are major, major viruses that are vectored by varroa mites. So something to definitely keep in mind. It's a huge problem. The reason that mites are such a big issue on European honeybees is because of this whole concept of chemical camouflage. Essentially, chemical camouflage, let me just back up for a second. Bees and insects in general communicate via smells. And we call this chemical ecology. So that is the communication of not only insects, but also plants. So bees perceive their environment a lot of times by smell. They communicate via smell. They can detect, you know, bad guys coming into the hives via smell. You know, bees that don't belong to that hive, they will, you know, guard bees will check them at the door and basically see if they've got the right smell. So smell is very important. The problem with varroa mite is that varroa mite has this ability to take on the smells of anything it touches. And we call this chemical camouflage. Essentially, when a varroa mite comes into contact with a honeybee, it takes on the what we call cuticular hydrocarbons, which are basically just smells that are on the surface of us, on the surface of bees, on the surface of everything. The mite takes on these cuticular hydrocarbons and essentially becomes completely camouflaged by smell. The mites are essentially invisible to European honeybees because there is not that co-evolved relationship like we talked about with Apis serrana. Apis serrana, because it has evolved with varroa mite over thousands of years, is able to pick up the very, very nuanced differences between the smell of varroa mite and honeybees. European honeybees do not have that ability. The antennae that they have chemical receptors on them called chemoreceptors. And the chemoreceptors of European honeybees have not developed the ability to detect the small differences in smell of the varroa mite. So varroa mite is essentially invisible inside a regular European honeybee colony. Now, some bees, we have been working, scientists have been working on this, like I said, for decades, trying to get European honeybee that is able to detect, attack, and remove varroa mites from a hive. There's a few genetic lines that will do this and have been shown to do this in research. And always, I'm going to point you to the scientific stuff, not the BS that's all over YouTube. So Purdue ankle biters are a line of honeybees that were developed at Purdue that essentially attack varroa mites. They have the ability to detect them and they will attack them. They will chew on them and those mites will just fall to the bottom of the hive and die. I have purchased Purdue ankle biters in the past. We have a few colonies, actually our oldest colonies in Michigan, 6-year-old colonies, originally came from Purdue ankle biter stock, and we still breed queens from those colonies that have some of those qualities. They tend to keep the mites in pretty good check. However, it does not mean that you stop monitoring. You still monitor because problems can get out of way, and over time, these genetic lines can get diluted. So your queen from this year that was purchased as a Purdue ankle biter, that queen, you know, next year you're gonna maybe, you know, take a queen or take some queen cells from that colony to develop a new queen. You know, that queen that was in there that was a Purdue ankle biter went and mated with a drone that was likely not a Purdue ankle biter. And so the genetics get diluted over time. Another line of what we call hygienic bees, which are bees that will detect, attack, and remove varroa mites, are the varroa-sensitive hygienic bees, also known as the Minnesota hygienics. These were developed at the University of Minnesota. They have the ability to detect, attack, and remove varroa mites. The Russian line of honeybees, because these bees basically evolved in Eastern Europe, we believe that there was some interaction with Apis serrana at some point, and they have the ability to detect varroa mites in their colonies. So the Russian lines of honeybees were actually a target of U.S. researchers or in the early days of varroa mite, really trying to get a handle on controlling it. And so the USDA had a large research project that is still going on, where they were basically working with beekeepers to develop a network of Russian producing beekeepers. So beekeepers producing Russian honeybees. And you can still find these beekeepers around the United States. There's a whole organization dedicated to those particular breeders. If you are looking for Russian honeybees, I would recommend looking on the internet for the breeder network of Russian honeybee breeders that was actually developed by the USDA. You don't want to just purchase stuff from people who are saying they're Russians, because a lot of times that's a way to get a little bit more money for your product. Make sure you're buying something from a reputable source is what I'm saying. Africanized honeybees. We don't have those in Michigan. Those of you that are taking the class in other states, particularly the Southwest, you absolutely have these. California, the southern portion of California, I had interactions with Africanized bees back in my days in California. We've also had interactions with Africanized bees in places like Arizona, New Mexico. I believe they're in Texas as well. So a lot of the Southwest is affected by Africanized honeybees. The caveat, the first thing is the Africanized honeybees are very aggressive. They are typically cause death of a lot of pets every year. I remember growing up in Southern California, and every year you'd hear somebody's dog got killed, or somebody was killed by an attacking hive. Typically, somebody mowing their lawn and getting too close to an Africanized hive. They're very territorial. However, caveat to all of their aggression is that they are very, very good at managing varroa mite. They also are pretty resistant to most bee diseases as well. So they're very robust and very resistant bees if you're brave enough to manage them. So there's a little something to that as well. All right, so monitoring for mites. You're going to do this every month, and you're going to do this with either the sugar roll test or the alcohol wash. The way that you do this is you're sampling 300 bees, which is about a half a cup of bees. If you have if you have 9 mites or more that you find in your 300 bees, that is a 3% infectivity level, and that needs to have a treatment placed on it. You don't want to wait on this. You want to do it immediately. Once when you're doing your monthly inspections, I do my sugar roll test. I shake my mites. If I have above 3% infectivity, I have my treatment option with me as well, which I will put right on there. So you need to make sure that when you're doing this, you're ready to take action if your threshold is met. 3% infectivity is what we're using. And this is something that is evolving over time. There is some research being done currently to determine if the 3% infectivity is actually the right level, that maybe we need to drop this a little bit, especially in the early part of the season. So just keep your eyes posted, as new research is coming out. But right now, the 3% infectivity level is what we're using as the hard number. I will say this, though. If you're seeing 2% infectivity in June, you need to treat, because that is a really high infectivity level for that early in the season. Typically, mites start low in the season, in the beginning of the season. By the end of July, they start ramping up really rapidly. And by August, if you haven't done anything, they are off the charts. So if you're seeing, 2% infectivity in June, in my apiary, I would probably treat that high, because that is a pretty high level for early in the season. Control methods. So there's many control methods for varroa mites, lots of products out there to choose from. If you're looking for organic control methods, and these are the methods that we use in the Heroes to Hives program, we are very successful with these methods. In my personal apiary, these two methods are the only methods that I use for treatment, and we tend to see somewhere around a 10% or lower loss annually. That is very, very low. The new USDA figures came out a month or two ago, and we're almost at 40% overwintering loss last year. So that's well below what we're seeing on a national average. The two organic control methods that are certified organic that you can use in a certified organic operation are formic acid and oxalic acid. Formic acid is formulated as MitoWay Quick Strips, or Formic Pro, which is the new formulation. You can use this method, formic acid, during the season when you have brood. So when the queen is laying and when there's brood, you can also use this method when your honey supers are on. And that is really important, because most control methods that we have, particularly those that are conventional methods, you cannot use with honey supers on. This you can use with honey supers on. It is a vapor. It penetrates the cappings of the brood, which is why you can use it with brood on, and it'll kill those mites in the brood and those on the bees. Oxalic acid is a little bit different. We use this as either a sublimation or dribble technique. Now, sublimation is the vaporizer. If you're familiar with that, you use a little bit of oxalic acid on a disc that is heated. You put it in the hive, it vaporizes those crystals, and the crystals move throughout the entire colony. Now, the caveat to oxalic acid is that that chemical cannot penetrate brood cappings. So you generally do not use oxalic acid with brood on. If you do want to use oxalic acid with brood on, you need to use it for like a 3-week period, maybe like once a week. But generally, you want to use it without brood on. I use formic acid during the season, meaning, you know, whenever I have brood on. And then I use oxalic acid generally in the fall as the last treatment I do before I put my bees to bed for the winter. I wait until there is no brood in the colony, and then I will hit them with oxalic acid. Now, keep in mind that both of these treatment methods have temperature ranges that you need to be mindful of. And especially with formic acid. Formic acid's got a really kind of a tight range. I think it's 50 to 85 degrees is where your treatment range is for daytime hives. You get above that, you're gonna smoke your bees. You get below that, it's not gonna vaporize. So you wanna make sure that you're using it under the appropriate conditions. Before I go any further, all of the instructions for using these treatments are on the bottle or on the product that you are going to purchase. The label that is attached to a pesticide, these are all pesticides, the label attached to pesticides is a legally binding document. That is a document that was approved by the EPA for use only as prescribed by the label. If you do not use the product as intended, as instructed on the label, you are doing an off-label application, which is illegal under federal law. Now, you're not gonna have somebody hovering over you, but that is something to keep in mind. And this goes for all pesticides used in agriculture. That label is a legally binding document. You cannot use the pesticide for any purpose outside of what's on that label. So you need to be absolutely certain that you read these labels carefully and you follow them as directed. Any use outside of that is an illegal use of that product and could potentially get you in trouble. Essentially, you're using a product, a pesticide, which is used to kill things in a non-legal manner, which could cause, ramifications as far as your product being able to be marketed, if someone were to find out about that. All right, so oxalic acid, you can use the sublimation method, which is the vaporization method, or the dribble method, which is what you see right over here. If you're interested in the sublimation method, that generally is a product that the wand is generally sold from Dayton, Man Lake, all of these companies. And if you're interested in the dribble method, that's a method that was actually developed by Randy Oliver. And Randy Oliver is out of California. He does a lot of kind of independent research with beekeeping, but he has the full method for how you would do that on his website, which is scientificbeekeeping.com. All right, the conventional approaches for varroa mites. Apistan is one product that is out there. There has been resistance that has been widely reported to this, resistance of varroa mites to this treatment, meaning that the varroa mites are not being affected by this treatment as well as they used to be. Apivar is another product. Czech mite, another one. Resistance has been reported in this product as well. So out of the products that you see here, the two that I would steer you away from are Czech mite and Apistan. Those two products, we have documented evidence that there is resistance to that product by populations of varroa mite. Apigard, another. Apilife Var, another, which uses Apigard and Apilife Var both use essential oils in their formulation, a thymol, which is from the thyme plant, and then Apilife Var is the eucalyptus and menthol added to that as well. These are not organic treatments, though, even though they are formulated with essential oils. And then Hop Guard is also a product that you can use, which uses hop compounds as well. So these are kind of your conventional methods that you can use for treatment. I'm not gonna get into the details of all of these. There's a lot to cover within each one of these. So if you're interested in any of these products, I would refer you to the handout that was sent with this particular lecture, which goes over all of these products and how to use them, what some of their drawbacks are, and what some of their advantages are. Okay, tracheal mites. So tracheal mites are another mite that affect honeybees. Arrived here in the 1980s. It's an internal mite that live in the trachea of the honeybee. So this is a trachea that you see right here, and you can see these little mites inside of the trachea. They feed on the hemolymph of the honeybee, and so they compromise bee development. They really more or less really reduce lifespan of honeybees. They can cause some dead outs, but really they typically affect overwintering bees because those bees have a much longer lifespan, and so these mites are able to get up into populations much higher than they would in your summer bees, which are only living 45 to 60 days. They can cause dead outs. Colony death, really during the winter, if you see a colony that has just tons of honey and there are not any other symptoms that really go along with the dead out, like your varroa mites were completely under control going into the fall, this could be a potential cause. The problem with tracheal mites are most of the symptoms are really unreliable. So it's a tough thing to actually nail down. Typically, you're going to have to get this under a microscope by someone who is a trained professional to actually identify them. So this would be one of those situations where you're going to want to lean on your experts if you think the tracheal mites are a problem. Basically, the life cycle of tracheal mites is like this. You have a young bee that is affected by that, by the tracheal mite. That is entered through a spiracle, which is where bees basically breathe from. That's their kind of their breathing hole. We'll call it their breathing hole on their abdomen, their abdominal segments. And so the mites get into those. You basically have larvae in the trachea. Those larvae turn into adults, and then those adults continue to feed on the hemolymph inside of the trachea. There are some control mechanisms that you can use for tracheal mites. There are resistant genetics to tracheal mites that are available. So you can get resistant bees to tracheal mites. But mite away quick strips actually do work for tracheal mites. So you know, when you're using mite away quick strips, you kind of getting a twofer. You're controlling not only your varroa mites, but you're also controlling your tracheal mites as well. Other products may not work as well. Apolife bar, I've heard people say that they can use these for tracheal mites. I've never seen a whole lot of, I've known a few people that have used this, but I just wanted to throw it out that there might be some other methods, but this is, the mite away quick strips really is the go-to method if you're gonna be working with tracheal mites. And so like I said, you know, you're getting like a twofer by using that product. Wax moths. So we have two wax moths that affect honeybees in northern Michigan, well, I say in northern climates. And these do pretty much are prevalent throughout the United States. So you have the greater wax moth and the lesser wax moth. Really, they have a lot of the same habits. And so the larvae, they're gonna feed on your protein and destroy wax. And they can actually destroy hives that are weak pretty fast. And the reason is because they're not only are they feeding through the protein, but they're also creating these webs here as well with all of this black stuff in there. That's all poop. So not only are they, so they feed on your protein and then go and destroy your wax in the process, but they're really after the protein. They're not after the wax, even though they're called wax moths. They're after the protein in the wax. But essentially, you know, if you get a colony, even a mildly strong colony that gets an outbreak of this, you can actually, this will contaminate your honey. You will not be able to harvest honey that has been contaminated by wax moth, either species. It's a real big problem, mainly for stored comb. And the reason that it's a problem in stored comb is because a lot of folks, when we go into winter, and we've all talked about how valuable drawn comb is going into the next season, you're going to end up storing a lot of your supers, a lot of your hive bodies that have drawn wax in them. The key to ensure that you are not getting affected by wax moth when you're storing your drawn frames is by ensuring that there is no protein in the frames. No protein. Pollen. You do not store frames with pollen in them because it attracts wax moths. They are after the protein. They're not after the wax. So if you have a stack of hive bodies that you have stored over winter that is all just drawn wax and nothing else in it, meaning there's no excess honey, there's nothing, it's just drawn wax, wax moth will not affect those hive bodies. If you put one or two frames in that stack of drawn frames that has nothing else in it, that have protein in it, pollen, you could potentially get a problem with wax moths through that entire stack of hives, a stack of frames. They're after the protein, but they will affect all sorts of other things as they're traveling in search of that protein. So for those of you who are storing frames over the winter, it is key that you go through those frames before they go into storage. What I do with frames that have pollen in them, because invariably you're going to get frames that have pollen in them that you're gonna not have a place for. You're gonna have to store somewhere. Generally, what I do with those frames is I will scrape the pollen out of them, meaning that I just take off all of the wax that has them on, and I will put them in an individual area in my garage. And instead of stacking the hive bodies, I tilt them on end so that light can get into the frames. These do not like light. They like dark conditions. And so as long as there is light exposure into the frames, you generally won't get wax moth. This is what it looks like when wax moth really goes to town on your wax. So they were feeding on protein. They destroyed the wax as well. And you can see that this is raw foundation right here that we just peeled this whole mess back from. This is very nasty to deal with. Again, all of this black stuff in here is fecal matter. So this is all poop from these wax moths. In a colony that's been contaminated with wax moths, you're not going to be able to harvest honey from, because it really is a food safety concern. Control methods for wax moths. Well, strong hives are generally not very susceptible when they're active. Only store frames without protein, so meaning pollen. Expose your stored equipment to light. They don't like the light. So if you're making sure that the equipment is exposed to light, that's a good thing. You can store frames with comb in a freezer if you have frames that do have pollen on them that you want to keep over for the next season. You can also use, there's also some products out there. Paramoth is an insecticide that you can purchase. Dichlorobenzene is the active ingredient. And this will also work for storing your colonies with some paramoth, or hive bodies with paramoth. Small hive beetles is our next pest, Athena tumida. It's all over the United States. Typically in northern climates, we don't see it at levels where it will actually cause colonies to decline. It's more of a nuisance pest. However, I have been seeing in southern Michigan this problem getting more and more. I give talks all around the United States, and last year I was in Virginia giving a talk. And in Virginia, this is a really bad problem. People lose colonies to small hive beetle all the time. And so it is becoming more of a problem, I think, in Michigan than we have seen previously. They're very visible. You can see them easily with the naked eye running around in the colony. And you'll see them moving around in the colony typically when you open them up and they get exposed to light. A lot of times they keep to kind of the corners of the colony. The bees will actually police them when they're in small numbers and kind of keep them sequestered in areas of small like corners of the colonies. One thing that we see with equipment is that if your equipment is deteriorating and gaps are starting to form in, say, hive bodies, a lot of times they will hide in those gaps because the bees can't reach them. So they are kind of they're very easy to see when you're inspecting a colony. They're black. They sometimes look a little dark brown in color, but typically black. The big thing about them is that they leave slime trails as they're feeding. So they're feeding on honey and pollen, but as they're doing that, they're depositing yeast, which ferments the honey and pollen and really turns it into like a slime, which becomes just a total mess if you've got this in really, really high numbers. They can contaminate your honey with fecal matter as well. So again, something that can affect your final product. They can overwhelm weak colonies, even strong colonies at really, really high numbers. But again, for those of you in Michigan, I have not seen numbers high enough in Michigan to actually kill out a colony. And one of the other things that can happen is that if the infestation gets too bad, and this goes for, you know, varroa mite too, the bees will just leave. They'll abscond the hive because the pest pressure has gotten so bad. So if this does get to a really, really bad level, you could get to a point where your bees just abscond from the hive. This is some of the sliminess that you will find in a colony that is widely affected by small hive beetle. You can see this is what they look like. This is the end of a frame right here, and you can see very easily this cluster right here at the edge of this frame where it meets the hive body. Why are they here? Well, because it's where the bees can't really get to them very well. So they're generally can wedge their ways, or their places, or they can wedge themselves in places that bees can't get to. So it does become quite a problem because they can't monitor, or they can't basically regulate that pressure. Like I said, in small numbers, the bees will sequester them in areas of the hive. But in large numbers, they can get out of control pretty quickly. Control methods. There's all sorts of control methods for these. Typically, traps are adequate. There's a lot of traps out there. Beetle Be Gone sheets. You can use the Swiffer sheets, the unscented Swiffer sheets as well. There's CD cases is one of the, when I was first getting into beekeeping, this is how we were basically catching all of them, is basically putting CD cases in. They get into the CD cases because they're trying to hide from the honeybees. And you can just remove that case, throw it away. Beetle Be Gone sheets, basically what happens with them and with the Swiffer sheets is that the bees will kind of chew up the material, and then the beetles get stuck in them. There's also just regular beetle traps as well that work pretty darn good as well. If you have a big problem, or if you're in a state where this is a really big issue, there are products out there that you can use to help with this. GuardStar is an insecticide, permethrin, that you can use to control this. It is a labeled pesticide, meaning that it is labeled by the EPA for use on honeybees for controlling small hive beetle. You use this as a soil drench. Now, the reason that you use this as a soil drench is because the life cycle of this particular pest, its larval stage and adult stage takes place inside of the hive, and its egg stage takes place inside of the hive. When it pupates, when it goes from turning into a larva to an adult beetle, they actually pupate in the ground right outside in front of the hive. So they come out of the hive, they drop to the ground, they burrow into the ground, they pupate into the ground, and then the adults hatch and then move back into the hive. So when you're using a pesticide like permethrin, GuardStar, for this, you're using it as a soil drench in your apiary, and it drenches into the soil, it kills the pupa in the soil. Caveat to this is it's highly toxic to honeybees. So, you know, when you're applying it, you generally want to apply it in off hours when bees are not flying and when they're not going to come in contact with the soil. Generally, a good rule of thumb for using any pesticide is it's safe once it's dry. When it's in a liquid, when it's, you know, if you soak the ground in front of your beehive, that is going to be toxic to honeybees until it dries. Once it's dry, you're safe, you're good to go. So using it in off hours, like in the evening after bees have all come back and they're in the hive, this would be a good time to apply that. You can also use ground covers. I've seen people use cardboard. I've seen people use weed exclusion or weed cloth, the exclusion cloth for keeping weeds down in farms. All sorts of materials, basically to create a barrier between the ground and the beetles. And so you would basically set up your entire apiary on cardboard or weed cloth, and that would basically create a barrier so when the mite comes out of, or I'm sorry, the beetle comes out of the hive and tries to drop down into the soil, it literally can't get into the soil. There is a physical barrier there. So that's a good method as well. Another method, a biological method, is predatory nematodes. Heterohabitus indica is a predatory nematode that you can use in your apiaries to control small hive beetle. And I actually had it, we had an apiary in Holt this year, Holt, Michigan. It had a pretty high beetle concentration. I mean, much higher than I was comfortable with over the course of the season. And we were using the Swiffer sheets and catching a lot of beetles, but it wasn't catching all of them. And so last year when we got done with the season, I thought, you know, I'm going to take some preventative measures here. In the 2019 season. And so at the beginning of the season, what we did at that apiary was we applied these predatory nematodes. You buy them, Arbico Organics, A-R-B-I-C-O, is the company that developed these. And you basically buy them and they come in a packet and it's like a gel matrix and you have all of these live nematodes in there. You basically mix it with water, and then you water the area around your beehives with it. In that apiary where we did that, and we did that in early June, I have seen, and we still are monitoring for mites with beetle begone sheets, or, well, we use Swiffer sheets, but we're still monitoring, and I have not seen not one of these beetles show up in any of the hives where we had quite a high presence. Well, I say high, but high for Michigan presence last year. So they, I will say from my own personal experience, they work pretty damn good. However, I will say this also, they're a little more expensive. Anytime you buy biological organisms to kill other organisms, we call this biological control in the pest management world, it is going to be expensive because you're dealing with a live organism. These generally have to be shipped overnight or second day air, so the shipping generally is pretty expensive. Usually you can expect to pay about the same amount it's going to cost you for the product just in shipping when it comes to biological products. And that's pretty ubiquitous across biocontrols, whether it's in honeybees or in regular agriculture. All right, vertebrate pests. So skunks, bears, raccoons, mice, and ants, which ants are not a vertebrate, but I put them in there because they're a nuisance pest. But these are some of your major pests that you're going to be dealing with. So the vertebrates, like skunks, bears, and raccoons, they can all cause major damage to your apiary. You know, we've talked about this time and time again, that bears are terrible beekeepers. They destroy everything and really cause big havoc for a lot of folks. The solution to this is by keeping them out of the apiary, and the only way you're going to do that is with an electric fence. Don't mess around with some slow voltage electrical fence. I have played around with low voltage fences, and although we have not had any bears in any of our apiaries, you know, anytime you can grab onto a fence and it doesn't make you think twice about going in there, it's definitely not going to make a bear think twice about going in there. So you want an electric fence that's got a good pop to it. The electric fence that we use in our apiary, and we only have this in our apiary in the UP because our apiaries in the Lower Peninsula don't generally have bear populations around them. But in the UP, we are in a high bear density area. We have a 6.5 joule electric fence that will run 120 miles of fence. It is the biggest charger that they sell at Farm Supply. So if you go to or a Tractor Supply. If you go to Tractor Supply and you look in their electric fence area, I think it's like a $200 charger. That is a good charger for keeping bears out. It'll make a bear think twice for sure. The other thing that you can do, and it'll definitely make a raccoon or a skunk think twice, you want to make sure that when you string your fences that you have several different heights for all of these different predators. But generally, you know, this is going to keep your bears and your vertebrate pests out. The other thing you can do is ratchet strap your hive. I ratchet strap all of our hives at every apiary we do. That's just how I was taught to do it by my mentor. And so we've done that as just regular practice. That does help. A bear may knock over a beehive, but may not be able to get it apart because of the ratchet strap. But that's not to say that a motivated bear won't make quick use of that ratchet strap. The one thing that I just saw recently, and because this is a long lecture, I don't mind digressing. One of the things I just had recently with a client of mine up in the UP is we had sold a beehive to her, and she had got a screen bottom board with that beehive. And generally screen bottom boards, you know, they're not used for, we don't use them for Roborilla management, but I actually do like screen bottom boards sometimes for the winter because it actually gives you very good ventilation. And you generally don't see a lot of fungal growth inside of the colony when you have that mound of dead bees at the bottom that just naturally die over in the colony over the winter. So she had a screen bottom board as part of this purchase. She had a bear that came to her home and it basically knocked over the hive, got into the hive and, you know, destroyed a lot of brood, essentially, because that's what the bears are after. They're after the brood. She had that hive ratchet strapped the second night it came, and that bear basically punched a hole in the bottom of that screen bottom board and continued to just reach into the colony and rip out frames. The third day the bear came, she had put the bees in a barn, in a small barn, to protect them because the bear just kept coming back. The bear actually ripped the side off of the barn to get to the bees. So the lesson of that is a motivated bear is going to be really tough to slow down in an apiary. And the only way you're going to do it is with a really, really hot electric fence. So something to keep in mind. I'll jump down to the mice because that is our other vertebrate pest that is in this slide. And that pest particularly is pretty easy to manage. Mice do cause all sorts of issues. They will get in a colony and make a mess. You know, they make a nest in there. It really gets gross, especially over wintertime. But you're gonna use an introducer for that, a mouse guard for that, so that they just can't get in. But you also, you know, you can raise your hives off the ground. And raising your hives off the ground should just be normal practice. The higher they get off the ground, the less likely they're to be affected by some of these smaller pests. Ants, which are not a vertebrate, but are on our vertebrate slide, tend to be a nuisance problem. I generally say that it's location, location, location when it comes to ants. When you're picking your apiary site, note where there are big ant colonies, and don't put your apiary where there are big ant colonies. Ants tend to like to be on trees as well, so if you have trees that are very close to your colonies, that typically can cause issues with ants. One of the other big things that causes issues with ants is old equipment. As equipment ages, it starts to get holes in it, you know, it starts to get worn, and particularly with inner covers and top covers, as they get worn, as the wood starts to break down, you'll see a lot of ants that will actually dig out passages in that rotten wood, and will actually develop full colonies in woodenware. I have a lot of equipment from when we first started that I brought out from California with us that's, you know, 10 years old and is getting worn, and it's particularly some inner covers and top covers that just the wood is just, it's on its last leg. And we're seeing in some of those situations where the wood is deteriorating, where these ant colonies are just taking root. And really the only way to get rid of them, I would say, is to cull your equipment. As you know, as you start to see ant colonies making colonies inside of your woodenware, get rid of that woodenware. You know, makes good firewood, but you know, this equipment's cheap to replace. The last thing you want to do is compromise a beehive because you don't want to spend $20 on a new top cover. So changing out old equipment can help with that as well. But generally, ants can be a big issue. Diatomaceous earth around your hive stands can help. Please note that diatomaceous earth is also damaging the honeybees, so you don't want to put it, you know, on the bottom board landing or anything like that. But it can work as a barrier around the feet of, say, your hive stand. All right, so now we're going to jump into pathogens of adult honeybees. So we're going to talk about adult honeybee pathogens, and then we're going to talk about pathogens that affect the brood. So the first thing we're going to talk about is Nosema, and then we'll get into some dysentery issues. So Nosema, there are two strains of Nosema that we have in the United States, Nosema apis and Nosema serrana. Nosema apis, typically we see earlier in the season. It's the most common disease of adult honeybees. It affects the gut of the honeybees, and it's a fungal microsporidia. And so it disrupts the gut and causes diarrhea. And what you see on the top here is these microsporidia. And then at the bottom, this is what you would see in a situation with Nosema, where there is just diarrhea everywhere on the front of the beehive, inside of the beehive. Again, typically with Nosema, you see this early in the season with Nosema apis. But when you see a colony that has this just poop all over the front end of it, that is a really key indicator that you may be dealing with Nosema. The big thing about Nosema is it rapidly reproduces. 30 million spores can be developed within 2 weeks of infection, and that is a lot of spores that are going throughout the colony. In serious situations, it can kill an overwintering colony. An overwintering colony will succumb due to Nosema. And you should always keep in mind with overwintering colonies that they will not defecate inside of the hive. They wait for those warm days when they can get out of the hive and do their business. If you see frames that are coated in diarrhea, that is a good indicator that that is a sick colony, potentially by Nosema. The impact of Nosema on your honeybees is pretty dramatic. Reduction in lifespan, typically a 50% reduction in lifespan. When you're talking about overwintering colonies, boy, that reduction in lifespan can be devastating. a reduction in overall honey yield, a reduction in population, and impacts the salivary glands function, Nosema does. And so those are your nurse bees, which are feeding your young bees. So there it is affecting your population. It ages bees faster. It causes hormonal development disruption. And in some cases can cause early foraging by honeybees. It also affects digestive enzyme production, so it can oftentimes result in starvation. The food that's being eaten is not being digested and the proteins are not being assimilated into the body, so can result in starvation. So a pretty serious thing. I will say that we don't see a lot of Nosema in northern climates. It does come around, but typically healthy bees will be pretty good as far as resistance to, I won't say resistance, but they'll be able to deal with Nosema in small amounts. But colonies that are kind of on the smaller end or the weaker end, this can affect them dramatically. But not to say that if you get this really going in a colony, I mean, this will take out a strong colony, even a strong colony in the winter. Symptoms of Nosema. So some of the symptoms that you'll see with Nosema is that they won't eat sugar syrup. They typically are not able to digest anything, so they're not going to be taking up much food. They have trouble flying, and this goes along with them being malnourished. Feces on the hive body, the frames, the bottom board, and on the entry. You see all of this nastiness in here? That's all poop, and that's all from Nosema. You also will see things like shaking, dragging of their legs, or stumbling. And again, this goes back to essentially starving. That they're not able to digest things properly because the digestive enzyme profile in their stomachs has been disrupted. Best practices for prevention of Nosema: clean water. Honeybees are animals, and you should treat them like you would treat any sort of livestock. You would not feed your cattle nasty water, just like you wouldn't feed your honeybees nasty water. So a clean water source is really important. Rotating your comb, getting rid of your worst comb every year, culling your nasty frames. You know, those frames cost you a couple bucks. They're not worth compromising $200 or $300 beehive or, colony of bees. So rotating your comb, getting rid of that nasty comb over time is a good just sanitary practice for reducing chances of Nosema. Good ventilation in the winter. We tend to see that high humid environments kind of correlate with Nosema infection. Reduced exposure to straight line winds. So making sure that your colony is well protected during the winter can also help with reducing some of the susceptibility because you're reducing stress load on the bees. So straight line winds, meaning that if you live in an area where it is just wide open pastures and you have winds that just race across that landscape, you need to get something up around your bee colonies and not enclosing your bee colonies, but just some sort of a windbreak to cut down on those straight line winds. Good sun exposure, meaning that you have good southern facing apiaries. We talked about this as far as apiary selection. South facing is really important because during the winter, when we get sun exposure, that bee colony needs to get warmed up. It needs to be south facing. And that is when your bees are going to go and defecate and take care of their business outside. So good sun exposure can help as well. Don't move your bees too much. So again, reduction of stress. Stress causes all sorts of issues as far as pests and pathogens with honeybees. And replace any soiled comb. That soiled comb has that microsporidia in it, and you need to get rid of it. Way you can get rid of it is this lovely picture right here. Frames make great fires. They get a really hot fire out of a lot of beeswax. So when you have equipment that is, that is soiled or, has run its life, feel free to use that as firewood. There are some control methods as far as chemical controls. Fumagillin is an antibiotic, and it can be used for treating Nosema. It's typically fed in the syrup, so you typically would do a fall or spring feeding. There's a lot of reports that it's becoming ineffective at Nosema. You can't use it during the nectar flow, so that's one caveat to that, but typically you wouldn't. You're going to be feeding during the fall or the spring. The veterinarian feed directive does require that you get a prescription from a veterinarian in order to actually even purchase fumagillin, so that's something to consider. and you need to follow best practices for prevention control. That really is your best bet, is following best practices. You know, this list of practices right here is your best way to prevent this. But if you do get in a situation, there is a product that can help you out. All right, so dysentery. This is related to poor diet. This is dysentery related to poor diet. Again, lots of poop all over the place. This really is related to poor food sources. So fermented food. So when you're dealing with honeybee colonies and you have old nasty frames from a dead out, you know, last winter that you're going to put into a colony this year, you know, when you see things like fermentation, nasty smells, mold, these types of things, those things are gross, and those things are poor food resources. Pollen degrades over time. Pollen is not good forever. It is really only good for a pretty short period of time, and definitely not from year to year. So fermented food like pollen or that honey that was not capped last year that you've been hanging on all winter to feed to your bees in the spring, that honey ferments to alcohol, and that causes issues. So you want to make sure that you're giving your bees good food. Contaminated syrup, meaning that, you know, you're feeding sugar syrup, but you're letting mold grow in there, and you're just refilling the bottle time after time, and more mold's growing after each time you feed it. That, again, can cause some issues with dysentery. Typically, we see this in late winter when we're dealing with poor food resources and long periods of humid confinement, that you can see development of dysentery. Symptoms that you will see are fecal stains, swollen abdomens, and lethargic bees are some of the symptoms that are related to dysentery. Dysentery related to pesticide exposure. So some of the most common ag pesticides that you're going to see that bees get exposed to are pyrethroids, neonicotinoids, and organophosphates. Exposure to these can be acute or chronic. Excuse me. Acute exposure, which is direct contact, basically you're going to have lots of dead bees or missing bees. That is typical pesticide exposure. If you have this situation where your bees are coming into direct contact with pesticides, and one of the key signs when you see pesticide kill is that you'll see bees dead out in front of the hive with their proboscis sticking all the way out. If you see this situation, or if you suspect that your bees have been compromised due to pesticide exposure, which can manifest into some dysentery, talk to your local farmers and talk to them about when they're going to be spraying. You know, you should be in communication with your neighbors. You have honeybees. If they're using pesticides, you just, you know, want to know when they're going to be spraying, and you can close up your bees for that morning or that evening when they are spraying, so that there's no exposure. Again, when these pesticides dry, they are typically fine. Neonicotinoids being the exception because they're systemic. Chronic low-level exposure, so this is indirect contact via pollen and nectar. Neonics are typically the ones that cause this. They are systemic, so they are expressed in the pollen, and they're expressed most concentrated in the plant tissues, but they do get expressed in pollen and nectar. And so this is a low-level exposure over time, which can manifest in dysentery. Bioaccumulates in the hive. Also, neonics have been shown to impact honeybee memory, and we talked about that from the colony collapse disorder angle as well. So just some pesticide exposure can cause some of these dysentery symptoms as well. Best practices to avoid that risk is know your neighbors. So pesticide applications are typically done in the morning or in the evening by individual farmers, because wind speeds are low and you'd want to minimize drift when you're spraying pesticides. So that's typically when they're sprayed. So talk to your farmer, your local farmer that's, you know, in the field next to you, and you say, hey, you know, just let me know when you're going to spray and we'll just close up the bees for the day. That typically works just fine. You want to confine those bees when the sprays are occurring, and then once the sprays are dry, you're safe to let your bees out. You also want to give them as many resources as you can at home. The more habitat you develop at home, the farther the less a distance they're going to travel for resources. So developing your own habitat is a great way of mitigating some of the problems with exposure to pesticides. Clean water sources, also really important. Just keep your water sources and your food sources clean for your honeybees, just like you would with any other animal. All right, so now we're going to jump into the pathogens of the brood, and we're going to talk about viral pathogens, bacterial pathogens, and fungal pathogens. All a bunch of fun stuff to talk about. All right, so viruses. So just like humans, there are no treatments for viruses. There are no treatments for viruses when it comes to honeybees, just like us. So just keep that in your mind. Varroa mite vectors over 20 different viruses. We talked about two of the key ones, deformed wing virus and K-wing virus, and then also paralysis. So there's a lot of different paralysis out there, acute, Israeli, chronic. There's also sac brood, which is a virus as well. Symptoms that you're going to see in paralysis. So you see the symptoms with K-wing virus and deformed wing virus. Typically with paralysis, trembling bees, those greasy-looking hairless bees, bees crawling on the ground, bees that are unable to fly, all related to paralysis. So paralysis. On the left, in the first picture, you see a healthy honeybee, all sorts of nice furriness to him. On the right, you see a bee suffering from not only paralysis, but also deformed wing virus. On the right, these shiny bees that look kind of greasy, they are suffering from paralysis as well. So that is a key symptom that you can look at. So that's paralysis. I mean, really, that's the only way that you're going to see it, is how it manifests physically. Sac brood. So sac brood is a little bit different. Sac brood essentially affects larvae, and what it causes is the larvae to fail to pupate. So bees go through an egg stage, a larval stage, and then a pupal stage, where they transform from that little larva to a grown bee. If we cannot enter that phase, that bee will never become a bee. It will only die as a larva. And so what we see with sac brood is that we see the larva fail to pupate, and you see this middle cell right here. It ends up being a sac-like organism. And you can tell it's sac-like because you can actually, if you get in there with a pair of tweezers, you can pull this thing right out, and it's got kind of a leathery texture to it, so it's kind of like a sac. You will also see that the larva is stretched out on the bottom of the cell, and then the head is turned up. When it's down at the bottom of the cell like that, that is a position that you would not, it was just getting ready to pupate, but then it was halted at some point because of sac brood and its inability to move past that larval stage. What you will see in this situation is you're going to see that larva, which should always be a nice white color, start to change color. It'll turn from a white to a yellow and then to kind of a brown black color. And you can see in this picture, the head right here is a little bit darker color than the rest of the body. That's pretty indicative of sac brood. So again, a virus that's transmitted. The treatments, basically, that we use for sac brood is, number one, maintain healthy colonies, make sure varroa mite's under control, make sure that if you see this, if you start seeing affected brood combs, that you remove those combs. So anytime you see these types of issues where you're seeing sac brood in your colonies, get rid of these frames. There are no chemical treatments available for this, so it's all pretty much sanitary treatments and cultural methods to make sure that you're not getting sac brood or that you're taking care of it once it rises. All right, we're going to get into two big bacterial diseases here. So bacteria, American fowl brood is the big one. So American fowl brood, pretty much we thought we were going to lose the entire American honey industry to American fowl brood. 50s through the 70s, it was a really big issue. And again, I mean, we thought we were going to find the entire U.S. honey or beekeeping industry collapse from this particular bacteria. It is the whole reason that apiary inspection laws were put in place. And I'll say this, I know there's a lot of us who don't like government regulation, but the regulation that was put in place that allowed inspectors to come on your site, inspect your hives, and destroy your hives if they found American fowl brood during this period of time, all of which was done without your permission, that pretty much saved the American honey industry. And since then, particularly in the 80s and 90s, you've seen a massive reduction in regulation around honeybee production. In other countries like Canada, beekeepers are highly regulated. because we're a really valuable industry to the agriculture industry at large. The United States has dialed back on this a lot. And although, you know, I'm don't like having folks come out onto my property and inspect my bees either, we have to understand that if it weren't for some of the laws that were put in place back in, you know, the 70s and 60s and 50s, we would not be here today as beekeepers. So, you know, I'm not going to get into the argument about regulation in the current times, but this did play a very big role in saving our industry. So just know that. The cycle of transmission for American foul brood. So the larvae are fed American foul brood spores by the nurse. The spores proliferate in the larva, and then the pupal stage dies after it's capped. And it really becomes this gooey brown, nasty mess. What happens in this process is that housekeeping bees, once this pupal stage dies, they try to remove the bee, that pupal stage, and they become contaminated. And then they feed these spores, and then the spores just continue to proliferate. It moves throughout the colony and the food stores. And these spores actually will embed into the woodenware as well. Robbing of colonies that are hit with American foul brood will cause transmission of American foul brood to other colonies. So if you have one colony in your apiary that's affected and that starts to decline, then your bees from your other colonies will go and rob out that colony and they become infected as well, which is why inspections and destruction of those colonies is so important, because it transmits very, very readily in the environment. In woodenware, American foul brood spores will last for up to 80 years. Up to 80 years. So this is a disease that can affect generations of beekeepers just by being transmitted in woodenware. It's a really, really, really dire situation if you purchase woodenware that's used and it is affected with American foul brood. It is the most serious and contagious disease affecting honeybees, bar none. This will kill an entire beekeeping operation if gone unchecked. So it is imperative that you understand how critical your actions are when it comes to American foul brood. Symptoms and signs of American foul brood: sunken cappings. Cappings not fully closed. So you see in this picture here to the right, some of these caps are sunken. You see these perforations on the caps. These are symptoms that this could be American foul brood. Spotty brood patterns. You see this brood pattern right here, very, very spotty. And the most key characteristic, and experienced beekeepers like myself, I can open up a bee colony that has American foul brood and I could pretty much diagnose it before I even get into the colony. It has this really, really characteristic smell. It smells a lot like sulfur, like rotten eggs. And if you smell that opening up the bee colony, and for those of you that are going to join us this weekend for our beekeeping meditation course, we are actually going to spend some time smelling bee colonies, because the scent of a colony can actually inform you very, very much as to what's going on. If you smell sulfur in a colony, it's American foul brood, and it'll hit you like a ton of bricks when you open that colony. And you need to, if you smell something that smells wrong in your colony, you need to heed that as a very big warning. Healthy brood on the right, American foul brood on the left. And you can see these caps are kind of puffy. They're not sunken. They're not perforated. You can see that these are sunken, perforated, unhealthy colony. Healthy colony to the right. How do you test for it? Well, the smell is one way you can test for it. The other way is by doing a matchstick test. Essentially what you do is you take a matchstick or a toothpick, you stick it down into a cell. Typically I like to pick cells that, you know, have sunken cappings on them, because you're looking for the problem, not healthy cells. You're gonna stick it down in there, you know, twirl it around, and then you're gonna pull it out. And if you pull it out and you have this ropiness, like one and a half centimeters of ropiness, where that just kind of ropes out stringy-like, that is a good indication that you have American foul brood. And it generally is this coffee color, this kind of brown color. In addition, if you find that you have American foul brood, there is one treatment and one treatment only. And that is to burn all of it. It lasts 80 years in the woodenware. It is not worth sacrificing your entire beekeeping operation to try and save a couple hundred bucks in woodenware. It's just not worth it. You gotta burn it. That is the way that we deal with this. That's the way that we've always dealt with this. Some of your preventative measures, though, to make sure that this doesn't happen to you. And it is, we don't see this in high numbers right now. In Michigan, I have only seen this once in the last 6 years. But it does, every year, we get reports of a couple incidents. So it's under control, it's being managed pretty well, but it is still out there. So the way that you prevent yourself from getting this, and this is gonna be a shocker to a lot of you newbies, is don't buy used equipment. Don't buy it. If you have a beekeeper who has been losing their bees every single year and has decided to get out of the industry, which is typically the case, that they can't get their bees to survive and beekeeping just becomes too expensive over time. If you run into this situation, you don't want to buy their problem. And you don't know if what was happening was American foul brood or not. So buying used equipment, you're immediately, rolling in the dice. Now, I understand beekeeping equipment is expensive. If you know the beekeeper and you can talk to them about what happened over the course of the season, and you feel like, okay, maybe, if they were not monitoring for varroa mites, if they weren't managing for varroa mites, and they were seeing dead outs in, before the new year, maybe. But typically, you don't want to buy used equipment. Something that's been sitting in somebody's garage for 10 years, that maybe granddad, was a beekeeper and he died and this stuff's been sitting here forever, you have no idea what's happened with that equipment. If you're feeling like you want to take on a little bit of a risky endeavor, yeah, you can buy it. If you are going to buy used equipment, I always recommend that people scorch the equipment with a torch, because you're going to want to make sure that is the only way that you're going to kill any of those spores. Never let equipment that is not yours in your bee yard. Some of you have asked me why, I'd like to bring a hive tool or a smoker to one of our workshops. And on the syllabus, it says no outside equipment is allowed in any of the apiaries. This is why. Your hive tools, your frames, your smoker, whatever. Those spores can be transmitted onto any of those surfaces, and you do not want to be transmitting them from one colony to another or one yard to another. So hive tools, keep them at home. If it's not your apiary, or if it's someone coming to your apiary, wanting to bring bees to your apiary, wanting to use their own equipment at your apiary, I generally will not allow that. We've had folks that we've worked with over the years that have kept bees at our site as they were being trained. Some of our interns that we have as part of our business. If they do keep bees on my site, they will only keep bees that they purchased from me on that site. It's part of our integrated pest management program, and it should be part of yours as well. Always sanitize your tools as well. You guys that have come to the workshops, you see that little it's a container used for cereal that I carry with me all the time that has 10% bleach water in it. Every single time I come out of an apiary, the first thing I do is drop my hive tool into that 10% bleach solution to kill anything that's on there. That is a very important part of my sanitation practice. Additionally, if I run into a hive as I'm doing inspections in the yard that I suspect has American foul brood or any sort of disease at all, that hive tool, the second I close up that beehive, goes right into that 10% bleach solution, and I get another hive tool out, because you don't want to transmit these things back and forth between your hives. And a hive tool gets very, very dirty overuse, is a very good mechanism to transmit those types of problems. If you suspect you have it, a matchstick test is what you're going to do immediately. So that's the first step, is to do a matchstick test. If you suspect after your matchstick test that you have American foul brood, This is the number for those of you in Michigan that you would call. So everybody else in other states, your Department of Agriculture is who you're going to contact. There is a state apiarist who works for your Department of Agriculture. Here in Michigan, it's Michael Henson. And this is his address. That is his phone number. And that is his email address. So if you suspect you have American foul brood, you absolutely need to call the state inspector. The reason being is because this hive now needs to go in for testing to make sure, to confirm that this is American foul brood. And if it is American foul brood, we as a state, we as individuals who support the beekeeping industry across the state need to know about that. Because if this were to get out and this were to turn, you know, say for example, you were keeping four apiaries and you found American foul brood in one of them, but you've been transferring hive tools without cleaning them between all four of them. It could be that all four of those apiaries have American foul brood and that those apiaries are now interacting with other apiaries that are passing this pathogen around. It is a very serious thing. You need to get the proper authorities involved. You know, Mike is going to come out and he's going to do his tests. And if it does turn out that you have American foul brood, they're going to, he's going to advise you to destroy those hives. I would advise you to do the exact same thing. So just keep that in mind. European foul brood. So not as dire as American foul brood. American foul brood is the worst thing that you will deal with as far as pathogens are concerned. European foul brood, EFB, not as bad. It usually is most present in the early spring, typically when stress is on the rise. So when there is colonies that are growing rapidly, but there are shortages of food out in the landscape. That's typically when you see a European foul brood. These individuals die in the larval stage. So the difference between American foul brood and European foul brood is that American foul brood affects the pupal development, whereas European foul brood affects the larval development. So that's the C shape, what you see here. So they're most susceptible within 48 hours of being born. They're fed contaminated food. So it is actually the food where the spores are present. And what you see is discoloration. So like right here, this one right here is a pretty nice white color, this larva. Well, actually, this is actually a better example. Right here on this bottom picture, that small larva right there is that bright white color. That's the color that healthy larvae are. When you start seeing yellow and brown, that is an indication that that larva is contaminated with, has been fed contaminated food. So this, they actually will start to change color a little bit. The food itself is actually kind of it's an off color when it's being fed to them. It is highly contagious. Just like American foul brood. And typically one of the big symptoms is that you see these twisted larvae in here. So that's this is a larva that has been affected by European foul brood. The other key characteristic that you can see in this, and it is visible on this slide, is you see these little white lines all over the place that are moving, that are across this this membrane right here, the exoskeleton. That essentially right there, where'd my cursor go? Those are the trachea that you're seeing there. And actually, this might be an easier one right here. You see a few trachea right here. When you start, that is another symptom of European foul brood, is that you actually start to, you can see the trachea in the actual larva as well. But this twisted, discolored shape, that is a key characteristic of European foul brood. So the symptoms, uncapped cells, because typically this affects the larva, so you typically they won't be capped. You'll see this twisted larva. The larva can appear dry. So like this right here, you can see that normally when you have healthy bee larvae, they're going to have a nice pool of food with them. When they are starving or when they're being compromised as far as development, they can appear dry. So they tend to be this like yellow-brown color like this and dry. If you do the matchstick tips, you're not going to get any roping, but they do have a sour odor associated with them as well. This odor, I would typically associate more with like a rotten cheese than I would like rotten eggs, but it does have a distinct odor with it as well. Control methods for European fowl brood. Well, there is a treatment, a terramycin, which is oxytetracycline. Terramycin is available for treatment of European fowl brood. It prevents new infection. It doesn't cure the infected bees. So it just prevents the new infection, but it does require a prescription from your veterinarian. There are a couple other techniques that you can use. You can use the shook swarm technique, which is essentially because the bacteria is in the food, you're basically going to take the colony and shake it out onto new equipment. And so we call that the shook swarm technique. And then you're going to get rid of that equipment that's contaminated. Or you can remove the contaminated food. A lot of times what I'll do when I start to see European fowl brood, and this is very prevalent throughout Michigan and the United States. So, you know, most of you are going to run across this at one time or another. Very few of you are going to run across American fowl brood. But one of the things you can do, because it affects the food, is a lot of times what we'll do is I'll remove brood frames and pollen frames from the colony and get rid of them if I have a colony that has European fowl brood. And then what I'll do is I'll supplement them with pollen patties and start feeding them sugar syrup to clear out the European fowl brood. And typically it's a stress-related disease or pathogen. So they typically are more susceptible when they're stressed. So by adding clean food and having that food be present and in large amounts, a lot of times you can clear European fowl brood, especially if you catch it early. All right, fungi. So fungus is also something that we deal with in honeybees. And one of the big ones is chalk brood. I've seen chalk brood, I typically see it maybe once every couple years. It's just like you see it. It looks like the brood is like a piece of chalk, and you'll typically find them on the bottom board when you're doing inspections. It's not a huge risk. It won't take down a strong hive. It might have an additive effect on a weak hive if there's other things affecting the weak hive, but typically chalk brood is not something that's going to take down a colony. The control methods are pretty simple for it. It's a fungus. So typically it's associated with a lot of moisture. So one of the things you want to do is keep your hives dry and in a sunny location. Just simply a good location will help you out a lot with this. You want to get rid of any infected combs. So if you have combs where you do have chalk brood present in it, get rid of them. There's no registered fungicides for use on this. And typically just by creating a dry environment, you typically can take control of this pretty readily. If you're in a riparian area or like a really, really moist area where you have an apiary, that's typically not the best place to have an apiary. Typically high and dry spots is where you want to put them. But exposure to excess moisture will cause issues and may lead to chalk brood. All right, we're going to wrap it up just with colony collapse disorder. So I always bring this up in this lecture because this is a buzzword that all of us have heard. And it is most prominent that most of the public believes that honeybee decline is solely due to colony collapse disorder. And that is absolutely not true. Colony collapse disorder, although it does get a lot of press, is not the main causal agent of honeybee decline. It is one of the causes of honeybee decline. But typically, honeybee decline that we're seeing across the globe is more closely related to things like varroa mite, stress, non-target insecticides, things like that. For those of us that are smaller beekeepers, not commercial beekeepers, and this typically colony collapse disorder really only affects commercial beekeepers. It was first reported in 2006 in Florida by Dave Hackenberg. And he's gotten a lot of fame for this happening. So basically he had 400 hives that he had in an apiary, came back and there was only 45 hives that remained and there was literally no dead bees. That is a key characteristic of colony collapse disorder, is the fact that there are just no dead bees present. You would expect that if a colony dies, there'd be lots of dead bees to see that there'd be death associated with. And that's just not the case with CCD. Many commercial beekeepers have reported losses in some areas of over 50% of their colonies. Going out to a yard with 400 hives and only having 45 alive, boy, that would be devastating. I mean, I get upset when I lose one colony. I couldn't imagine losing that many colonies. But it typically hits commercial beekeepers that are migratory. So beekeepers that are moving their bees all around the country. And the reason that it typically hits them really is there's a lot of reasons. We don't know what is causing colony collapse disorder. As researchers, we have really been looking closely at all of the factors affecting commercial beekeeping operations. And the problem is that there are just so many stress factors when it goes to commercial operations. You can't tease apart the differences between each one of these factors. So some of the factors that we suspect are causing these issues, number one, neonicotinoids. We talked about this. This is the most widely used pesticide class in the world. 70% of all row crops that are planted in the United States have a neonicotinoid seed coating to them, meaning when they are planted in the ground, the pesticide's already on them. And then when the plant starts to grow, that pesticide is translocated into the tissues of the plant and expressed in those tissues. So we believe that neonics are playing a role. And we are seeing in Europe, there are some countries that are starting to ban neonicotinoids, and we are seeing a little bit of a bounce back in honeybee survival rates. So there might be something associated with that. But again, this is a multifactorial problem. And just honing in on that one factor, commercial beekeepers, this is just one of many factors their bees are exposed to. Varroa mites. Varroa mites obviously are a big issue for everyone in the beekeeping industry. And so that is another factor that is affecting these migratory operations as well. It's just varroa mite pressure. Stress. Stress is probably the biggest one. And stress is a real general term because there's a lot of things that cause stress in migratory beekeeping. One of the things that you see in migratory operations is that bees are being moved from place to place, being closed up for extended periods of time, being moved across several different climates over a short period of time is very stressful on honeybees. In fact, there's been research that has shown just the vibration of honeybees, of colonies being honeybee colonies just being on trucks and moving, that vibration alone causes stress that can cause immune systems to be compromised in honeybees. So in general, migratory beekeeping is just a stressful endeavor on honeybees. And these multiple stress factors, when they come together in kind of a perfect storm, that's kind of what we think is causing colony collapse disorder. But again, these combination of factors just make it really difficult to find any sort of a silver bullet for this problem. All right, so my final thoughts for today. This is a long lecture. I appreciate y'all staying with me on it. So some final thoughts. Well, beekeeping is really a fun and rewarding venture, but many beekeepers struggle their first few years. Those of you taking this course, you're going to be given a leg up, and most of our alumni do very well even in their first year. But you really need to understand that your first few years are going to be rough. It's a learning curve, and you need to take in as much knowledge as you can, not just Heroes to Hives. You need to be reading books. You need to be, paying attention to other experts. We all have different approaches to beekeeping. I have one approach. Megan Milbrath has a little bit of a different approach. But the one thing that I will say is that as a new beekeeper, when you are doing things and you are learning from people, you should be able to ask lots of questions, and that person should be able to tell you exactly why they're doing the things that they're doing. And there's usually a biological reason behind all of it. If they cannot tell you the reason that they're doing things, but they're just doing things because they want to do things, that's not a viable answer. So just keep that in mind. You may lose everything, even with experience. So I'd been keeping bees for 5 years when I came out to Michigan, when we moved from California to Michigan. I lived in an area of California, the Central Coast, where there is no winter. We typically see average temperatures in the mid-70s all year round. So I never had to deal with any of these winter issues that we have in northern climates. My first year in Michigan, I lost everything. We had 6 hives that we bought when we moved here. We lost all 6 of them because we just didn't have the experience. So be prepared. You may lose everything. And although you may lose your colonies your first year, I would encourage you not to get discouraged. But what I would encourage you to do is understand why you lost those colonies. Really look at your notes. Make sure that you've documented everything as far as your inspections go, and go back to those notes and review them. And if you review your notes and you see that you had mite loads that were way above the action threshold when you were in the fall, I can pretty much guarantee you that's what's causing the problem, is that you're not monitoring and treating for mites in an appropriate fashion, and your mite count is getting out of control. So even with some experience, you know, even though if you have some troubles early on, you know, reflect on why you had those troubles and try again. Just like any type of agriculture, there's a learning curve to all of this. Regular mite checks are a must. You got to do those all the time, you know, monthly at a minimum. There's no way around that. That's modern beekeeping. Don't wait to treat a problem. If you see a problem, take action immediately. Insects are very short-lived, and things happen very quickly in an insect environment. Bromites, 10 days per generation. 10 days is a very short period of time for you to react. So don't wait to treat a problem. If you see a problem, deal with it. And finally, knowledge is power. Like I said in the beginning of this slide, read as much as you can, learn as much as you can, go and to beekeeping meetings as often as you can, learn from the experts, and don't just rely on me. look to others as well, get other opinions as well, because we all have our own approach to things. All right, folks, with that, I'm gonna say thank you and hope you enjoyed the lecture.